here with Leslie S. Klinger, author of the new annotated H.P. Lovecraft. Les, thanks for being with us. We're excited to hear your talk today.
Thanks, I'm excited to be here.
It seems to me that H.P. Lovecraft has been gaining in critical
I think that's right.
acclaim.
I think that's right.
And your book is maybe a capstone to this process.
Well, without patting myself on the back, the fact that Norton decided to put this in the annotated series, I think is a big deal. Look at the other works, their volume, the annotated Edgar Allan Poe comes out, I think, next year. Other classics, the Sherlock Holmes stories. But you're right. I mean, the ascension, if you will, of Lovecraft really began in the 1970s when the academics discovered Lovecraft. There were other people who knew about it, but the academics focused on it. And of course, in the beginning, it was part of that general study of popular culture. And so Lovecraft got attention, but as people started reading it, it spread out into much more serious academic fields. Certainly, the first great milestone was the Library of America edition, edited by Peter Straub, that came out in the 2000s. But Lovecraft has come a long way. For a guy who was the quintessential starving writer, he's come a long way.
Yeah. You've obviously done many other annotated volumes, Conan Doyle, Dracula. Was the process of doing this one any different?
A little different, only in that Lovecraft has an immense quantity of correspondence. I mean, there are 85 stories, and one of the challenges here was to select which stories we're going to include in the volume. And there's some debate. I mean, my friends in the Lovecraft community have argued with me, why didn't you put that story in? Why did you put that one in? But in addition to the 85 stories, Lovecraft wrote maybe close to 100,000 letters. 100,000 letters. These letters range from postcards, still nonetheless cramped with information, up to letters that are 60, 70 pages long. So there's a tremendous volume of material about Lovecraft's thoughts and philosophies, where he got some of the ideas for his stories and so on. So that's a little unusual, certainly compared to the other projects that I've worked on, to have that much background material. The reason this is the new annotated Lovecraft is that there are previous annotated works. S.D. Joshi, a friend, has done three volumes that are six or seven stories in each volume. And S.T.'s annotations are all original thought. He is the leading biographer of Lovecraft and a great student of Lovecraft. But what I wanted to do in these annotations was to show the breadth of scholarship. There's actually a great deal more that's been written about Lovecraft, some of it academic, but a lot of it by the fan community, if you will, the Lovecraftians. And ST's annotations don't really look at those. They are his own thoughts and biographical information about Lovecraft. So I wanted to show the wide range of Lovecraft studies that's going on in various amateur magazines and academic journals.
So you've brought it up a couple of times, the Lovecraft community. How diverse is this group of Lovecraftians?
Well, it's an interesting community. Because a significant segment of it is gamers. The Call of Cthulhu RPG, which started out once upon a time as a Dungeons and Dragons kind of game, has taken hold and has its own strong subculture. And so any gathering of Lovecraftians, there are a certain number who cross over. There are some who are only there for the gaming aspects. And there are some who are only there for the sort of the books or the biographical aspects. But Necronomicon, for example, that was held in the convention, not the book, was held in Providence last year. there were, I think, 1,500 people in attendance. So it's a wide community. And what I've observed of it is that, like I see in the Sherlockian community, there's a wide range of age and occupations. There are writers, scholars, lawyers, doctors, school teachers, skewed probably toward the older, because that tends to be what happens in these genre-focused communities. It's people either working in the field and so on. But thankfully, a significant number of young people who are coming along and one day will be the older people in the community. So,
right. Well, finally, I wanted to bring up that you're also doing a series of books on the Annotated Sandman. And, of course, you're here today with speaking with Neil Gaiman. What are the differences between working on annotating something with a living author?
Yes, I was going to say, the first big difference is that Neil is alive and can read the annotations and say, well, you didn't quite get it. But it's actually been a really interesting process, because there's been some of that. Mostly it's been me asking questions, why did you do that, Neil? And sometimes he scratches his head and says, I don't know, or I don't remember. But in many cases, he's able to sort of dig up an explanation. It's been very interesting. Annotated Sandman was a great project because Neil made available to me scripts. One or two of the scripts have been published, but Neil learned, he says, to write scripts from Alan Moore. Alan legendarily started this whole business of, you take a 22-page comic and you produce an 80-page script for it that goes into enormous detail about what you want on the page. So Neil's scripts are very detailed. His are typically 40 to 60 pages per issue. But they're interesting because they're not only detail, they're not only backstory. They're also, in many respects, almost like diaries, because Neil, they're like letters to the artist, and so he'd be writing things about, his daughter had the flu, or he's got a bad cold, or isn't it amazing, some coincidental song is just played on the radio while he's writing this. So it's really, in many ways, it was a very intimate experience. It was sort of like doing a biography and going through family papers. And I love Neil. I mean, he and I have been friends now for a long time. And the first half of our relationship had nothing to do with Sandman. It just was friends, and we shared interests in Sherlock Holmes and all that. And we joked about doing the Annotated Sandman, and he'd always said, wait till I'm dead. And I'm glad we didn't. So it's been a lot of fun. We have the third volume, as you mentioned, is just out. The fourth volume will be out, we hope, in the spring. And maybe there'll be a fifth volume. We'll see. Neil hasn't finished the six issues yet for the climax of Sandman. When those are done, DC said maybe we'll do a fifth volume. So we'll see.
Great. Well, thanks again for talking with us, and thanks for your beautiful and important book here.
Thank you so much.